The world is changing fast. Ailing, burdened, consumed by man's unquenchable thirst for profit. Lately, nature is beginning to assert its true power.
The Philippines woke up to this, an apocalyptic landscape.
The devastation never seen before emphasized the need to accelerate initiatives for disaster preparedness.
Tutuldukan na natin ang nakasanayang pagtitiis tuwing tagulan. Hindi na pwede ang bahala na.
To address the need for the development of a reliable early warning system, the Department of Science and Technology launched the Nationwide Operational Assessment of Hazards, Project NOAA.
Project NOAA came about after getting direct instructions, after the DOST got direct instructions from the President to come up with a comprehensive, long-term program that would address gaps in disaster risk reduction and management.
Inaugurated in July 6, 2012, Project NOAA sought to provide a 6-hour lead time warning to vulnerable communities against impending floods, using advanced technology to enhance current geohazard maps. A program that aims to improve and develop disaster science research using our local scientists and push for the use of advanced technologies and recommend innovative information services in the efforts of the government to prevent and mitigate disaster effects. An accurate, integrated, responsive early warning system to minimize damage and loss of life.
Ang Project NOAA po ang magsisilbing arko ng mga Pilipinong laban sa dilubyo. Sa tama at sapat na kalaman, sasanayan natin ang mga Pilipino sa puspusang kahandaan. Ito po ang magsasaguan sa atin tungo sa kaligtasan. Nasa kamay natin kung sisikat ang magandang araw ng kinabukasan.
We have to educate people to have a culture of safety. Disaster preparedness is everybody's business. Project NOAA represents the Bayanihan spirit of the Filipino, facing environmental challenges with a strong collaboration of over 40 partner agencies and organizations both here and abroad. Project NOAA is an umbrella of interconnected multidisciplinary component programs that focus on prevention and mitigation, preparedness, and capacity building through information dissemination and the education of communities. These component programs are the Nationwide Disaster Risk and Exposure Assessment for Mitigation Program, DREAM. DREAM uses state-of-the-art space technology applications to produce reliable, detailed, up-to-date hazard maps in 3D. It has generated high-resolution flood models for all 18 of the country's major river basins and is swiftly on the way to covering our 257 minor river basins, making it possible to simulate the effects of different types of rainfall and provide an early warning. DREAM was able to accomplish all these at a fraction of the cost and only 1/10 of the time. The data gathered is also useful for other applications other than disaster management. That is why DREAM has earned global recognition in 2014. The initiation of a system to identify, quantify, and map the storm surge threat to Philippine coasts. CHESM aimed to create storm surge inundation maps to analyze risks and predict threats to coastal areas. Now, all 67 coastal areas in the country, including NCR, have been mapped out, with storm surge models available on the internet at least 24 hours before the landfall of a tropical cyclone. The development of a hybrid weather monitoring system and production of weather and rain automated stations. A widely deployed network of locally developed weather instruments. Doppler radars produced under the latter's program. Solar-powered automated weather stations and automated rain gauges, all beaming in real-time weather and flood data to PAGASA's central servers. The emergency distribution of hydrometeorological devices in hard-hit areas in the Philippines. The Hydromet program bolstered our weather monitoring system with the installation of hundreds of hydrometeorological devices along the 18 major river basins of the country, providing a better picture of water levels crucial in anticipating floods. Enhancing Philippine landslide hazard maps with LIDAR and high-resolution imageries. The utilization of LIDAR technology and computer-assisted analysis of slopes and structures to identify the exact areas prone to landslides. 81 provinces, including NCR, have been mapped with data sets and uploaded to the NOAA website. The development and deployment of an early warning system for deep-seated, catastrophic landslides nationwide. A low-cost, locally developed, sensor-based system that is now on its second phase with better-designed, more accurate instruments deployed in 50 sites across the country. Forecasting landslides by monitoring soil moisture and movement. The establishment of a flood information network, a flood center that consolidates data from 848 automated rain gauges, 479 water level monitoring stations, and 86 weather stations, 13 Doppler stations, satellite imagery, and PAGASA's Maple radar to forecast the chance and amount of rainfall that may affect the 165 major cities and municipalities in the country. The data gathering is automated and runs 24 hours a day, constantly displaying predicted rainfall every hour for the next 4 hours. Disaster management using web GIS. A disaster management system that involves a common web portal where people from the different sectors of the public and government can easily access information and even input data to use in disaster prevention and management. Another award-winning innovation recognized all over the world. Improved weather forecasting through Project NOAA's Weather Information Integration for System Enhancement. The program employs a state-of-the-art supercomputer and enhanced analytics to process information and deliver better, wider coverage for forecasting the weather, increasing the accuracy level of forecasts to as high as 80%, expanding the spatial coverage for the detection of typhoons to even outside the Philippine area of responsibility, and advancing the ability to predict the weather 7 days in advance. Strategic Communication Intervention for the NOAA Program. The program encourages the use of Project NOAA across the different sectors of society, helping Filipinos understand and integrate relevant, up-to-date information into their daily lives. Science for Safer Communities. A nationwide information, education, and communication roadshow that includes disaster preparedness using Project NOAA, created to empower local government units and vulnerable communities as they prepare for extreme natural hazards. Project NOAA, empowering communities in times of calamities. Led by some of the country's best scientists, the project is highly driven to achieve a grand vision: build disaster-resilient communities through new platforms powered by cutting-edge science and technology.
The tools provided under NOAA have greatly changed the way disasters or calamities and their associated hazards are viewed and managed at the local level. The NOAA website has become a valuable tool in monitoring weather patterns and serves as basis for early warning systems developed even at the barangay level.
After its launch, we had our first experience with a great flood in the Philippines, which was related to the southwest monsoon rains. We call it the Habagat 2012 event. And during that time, the Marikina River swelled several meters, probably 7 to 8 meters. Not as high as Ondoy, but equally dangerous because the floods were up to the second floor. But despite that warning, great flood, no people died. There were zero casualties.
With this success, Project NOAA has begun its journey.
And we are in continuous search for the best science and the best technologies that we can apply to mitigate the adverse impacts of natural hazards.
Strengthening capabilities, saving lives.
Because of the data set, because of the know-how that developed natin, maraming mga additional or possible new R&D projects or development projects for disaster preparedness, even beyond disaster preparedness, para improving our productivity, agriculture. Maraming gamit ang mga informasyon.
Groundbreaking efforts and tools powered by countless men and women working together.
Tandaan po natin palagi na nasa iisang bangka lang tayong mga Pilipino. Ipagpatuloy lang po natin ang pagkakapit-bisig at pagkakaisa. At pihado po ako maabot natin ang ating minimiting destinasyon. Isang Pilipinas na mas ligtas, mas maaliwalas, at may mas malawak na pagkakataon sa kaunlaran para ho sa lahat.
The ark has set sail, and each one of us is at the helm. Adapt to nature's enormous challenges. Overcome disaster by being more equipped and better prepared than ever before. This is Project NOAA.
We live in an era where information is acquired and exchanged at our fingertips, and in an instant. As such, The idea of going to a physical library for needed information has become rather dreary and outdated. But what use is a wealth of knowledge, especially in the fields of science and technology, if it is available only to those in the urban and suburban communities, or the ones privileged with connectivity? In the Philippines, a huge percentage of our population has yet to access the internet, and what is usually online are basic, general information that are quite limited. The Science and Technology Information Institute of the Department of Science and Technology has made S&T knowledge within easy reach through its virtual library in a box. This is the Science and Technology Academic Research-Based Openly Operated Kiosk System, better known as Starbooks. Launched on June 24, 2011, Starbooks was envisioned to make S&T information for the grassroots, the library users in far-flung communities. Starbooks is encased in a pod which holds two computer units, one as the server and the other as the terminal. With thousands of digitized S&T resources in its system, Starbooks has become a treasure trove of science and technology products and research materials, scientific journals, instructional videos, and other learning tools, practically for everyone. The first few Starbooks were installed in 11 identified sites in Davao and Zamboanga. The following year, Starbooks found its way to 114 sites, 44 of which were in partnership with the Department of Education Regional Office in Leyte. In 2013, the Starbooks resources were greatly enhanced when the offline version of the Encyclopedia Britannica was integrated into the system and was made available in 103 more sites. In 2014, after setting up 134 new kiosk sites, Starbooks has already covered all 17 regions in the country. It was also in this same year that Starbooks was invited for paper presentation at the International Federation of Library Associations and Institutions held in France. Halfway through 2015, Starbooks sites in schools, public libraries, and government agencies already reached a total of 650 kiosks nationwide as of date. Starbooks has gained the approval and appreciation of local government units, and more sites are being programmed this year. Even as it is already nominated for the Civil Service Commission's Hero and Public Servant Award, Starbooks has attracted the attention of international library community. In June 2015, STII's Starbooks received the Presidential Citation for Innovative International Library Projects of 2015 from the American Library Association. The award was conferred to DOST-STII for making science and technology materials available to the general public in remote areas that have few information resources, no libraries, and little or no internet connectivity. In the future, Starbooks is envisioned to create more impact to its target publics by beefing up its content collections. The volume and quality of collections will be enhanced to serve as teachers' tool in science and technology education, and even allow the users to store pertinent information about their area or community through the citizens' archiving feature of Starbooks. Current target is to set up 1,000 additional kiosks this year, and Starbooks will even have an online version to expand library users' resources and experience. Starbooks, breaking barriers to S&T knowledge and connectivity.
Metal products have become part of the everyday life. Ornamental irons, signs and letterings, intricate art disc designs, and many more. These crafts require skill, expertise, and imagination to create. But they can also be tedious to produce one by one by hand. The foreign market introduced the computer numerical control, or the CNC plasma cutter, to the world to bring mass production of the metal crafts. It has entered into the landscape of the Philippine metal industry. Recently, the Philippine Department of Science and Technology Metal Industry Research and Development Center, or DOST-MIRDC, successfully produced a locally made CNC plasma cutter.
The machine building project is a promotion of the local machine building capability of the local industry. We're trying to promote that sophisticated machines such as CNC plasma cutter machine can already be found in the local industry. As part of the project, we went to a series of investigation, benchmarking from different types or brands existing in the foreign market. We benchmarked different sheet metal fabrication shop using foreign CNC plasma cutter machine.
From simple designs to intricate curves, the CNC plasma cutter produces smooth cut of metals. It ensures precision and refined artistry.
Having to acquire a CNC plasma cutting machine is a good investment. This machine will bring you higher productivity and versatility in your cutting operation, and as well as safety for your operators.
Instead of holding the torch and exposing workers to extreme heat, operators of the CNC plasma cutter hold the controller. This ensures the operator's safety while crafting a masterpiece.
The development of the CNC plasma cutter machine shows that Filipinos are at par with neighboring countries. We Filipinos, we no longer need to import such machines. It is better to patronize our own machines in order to help our economy also, and also help our fellow men.
The Filipino dares to believe it can be done. For every metal craft produced, a revelation of art and skill work hand in hand. And with a locally produced CNC plasma cutter, a bigger accomplishment has been achieved. Ensuring greater productivity, quality, and safety from the DOST to the world.
Rice is the major staple food of Filipinos, contributing about 35.7% of the average daily individual food intake, making it the major source of carbohydrates in the Filipino diet. White rice is the most consumed form of rice, based on the 7th National Nutrition Survey conducted by the Food and Nutrition Research Institute of the Department of Science and Technology. Brown rice is the form of rice that has undergone minimal milling. Its bran layer is a source of dietary fiber, minerals, and B vitamins. Production of brown rice reduces the power demand needed in polishing and whitening by as much as 65%. With the bran and embryo intact and fewer broken grains, whole grain milling recovery is as much as 10% higher than white rice. The FNRI DOST has successfully determined in 2012 the optimum conditions for extending the shelf life of brown rice so that it can be stored from 5 to 9 months instead of only 1 to 4 months depending on the variety. Guide in preparing and cooking brown rice. Measure brown rice. In a pot with enough water, wash rice by swirling through the hand. Discard the cleansing water. Depending on the age and variety, 1 cup of brown rice will be needing 2 cups of water for cooking and will yield approximately 2 cups of cooked brown rice. How are the recipes developed?
The FNRI organized two homogeneous groups among mothers and DOST employees to gather information as the participants described their perception, interpretation, and beliefs about brown rice. This is done to gain understanding of the participants' perspective of brown rice recipes, where they want brown rice to be used, benefits, and how to cook brown rice. The FNRI DOST has explored the culinary potential of brown rice through a series of recipe testing and sensory evaluation to achieve the acceptable form, texture, taste, and consistency. Depending on the theme, recipes are searched, modified, or simplified in terms of ingredients and procedure. Using the 9-point hedonic rating scale, recipes are evaluated by DOST-wide panelists for acceptability in terms of appearance, color, aroma, taste, texture, and overall liking. Estimation of energy and nutrient content per serving of the recipes, photo documentation, review, and finalization of recipes are performed to complete the process.
Ang kapuluan ng Pilipinas ay may mahigit sa 220 milyong hektarya ng baybayin at marine ecosystems na saganang pinamamahayan ng iba't ibang uri ng damong dagat. Bakawan. at mahigit sa 50% ng uri ng coral sa daigdig. Nakasalalay ang pagkain, kabuhayan, at iba pang pangunahing pangangailangan ng milyon-milyong Pilipino sa mga marine ecosystem na ito. Lalong-lalo na sa mga bahura o coral reefs. Ang mga bahurang ito ay pinanggagalingan ng taunang net benefit na umaabot sa 6 na bilyong piso mula sa turismo at 35 bilyong piso mula sa pangingisda. At 19 na bilyong pisong halaga naman ang binibigay ng ating mga bahura bilang proteksyon mula sa kalamidad. Kumbaga sa taong may karamdaman na nangangailangan ng pagsusuri. Ganitong pagsusuri rin ang kailangan ng mga bahura ng Pilipinas. Ito na rin mismo ang ginagawa ng programang National Assessment of Coral Reef Environments o NACER. Bawat isa sa atin ay may magagawa para sa pangangalaga ng ating marine ecosystems.
Why should we care for our coral reefs? The Philippine archipelago has over 220 million hectares of coastal and marine areas. We have seagrass, mangroves, and more than 50% of the world's coral species. The Philippine reef environment is an invaluable marine resource, generating 6 billion pesos for tourism, 19 billion pesos for shoreline protection, and 35 billion pesos for coral reef fisheries.
DLSU Shore is the SHIELDS Ocean Research Center, and it's one of the agencies implementing a DOST-funded program entitled National Assessment of Coral Reef Environments. NACER is the National Assessment of Coral Reef Environments, and it seeks to update our information about the health of our coral reefs. We seek to survey around 200 reefs around the country in 3 years. We look at how much coral is there, is there still a variety of coral on those reefs, are there fish there, are the associated habitats healthy. The last time a national assessment was done was in the late 70s, and all current policies and regulations in government are based on that old assessment. We're trying to update that now. Various government offices are involved in the management and protection of coral reefs. but their jurisdictions sometimes overlap. In other cases, some reefs are left unmanaged, and so we need a government body to coordinate all these things. In order for us to manage an ecosystem, an entity that is very important to our society, we first have to find out where they are, how they are doing, what is affecting their health, and if we know that, we can better adjust our policies, our regulations, so that we are able to keep that ecosystem healthy. And that's what the National Assessment of Coral Reef Environments is trying to do. Provide the basic understanding, the basic information to make those things possible.
We've always had problems with fishing overcapacity in the sector. The EcoFish project is intended to improve the management and sustainable use of coastal and fisheries resources in the Philippines. So that is what we're trying to do for the fisheries registration. We're trying to count the number of fishers all over the Philippines. Electronic connectivity in many of the islands is not there. So TV white space technology is giving us that connectivity to do this thing, this registration electronically.
Me and my family, we were at our house and we're going to have our breakfast. We felt a short tremor, then the 7.2 magnitude, it was very scary, and I have my two babies with me.
The soil are shaking, the houses are really, the trees are bending. So we understand, we observe that it is already earthquake. We are so scared, and I am so sad during that time. So we just pray that hopefully a few minutes or a few seconds, it will stop.
On November 7, I was still here in school. I secure all my computers in the laboratory. I place it in the center of the classroom, but actually we lost everything. It's not only the classrooms, but included the facilities, the computer facility, the equipment, everything. November 8, early morning of 4 a.m. or 5 a.m., I was in my home with my wife, because my wife was nine months pregnant at the time, and the expected delivery is any time that day. We don't know what to do. It seems like we are just waiting for our life to be lost.
Typhoon Haiyan, known as Yolanda in the Philippines, was one of the most intense tropical storms ever to hit the country. It claimed more than 6,000 victims and left 4 million people without homes. Estimated damages reached astronomical proportions. Quick, effective aid was needed more than ever before. Microsoft and its employees immediately donated more than $500,000 in cash, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of technology, and hundreds of volunteer hours. For the first time in history, the TV white space technology was used to connect 500 residents in affected areas and to facilitate 75,000 hours of Skype connections. Using three emergency.lu kits with low bandwidth Skype, we also enabled communications among 5,000 rescue workers. We also provided the affected areas further technical and maintenance assistance.
After assessing or having an assessment of the requirements of the communities and the other stakeholders like our NGO partners, the number one thing that was immediately needed was really to establish some infrastructure so that people are able to communicate.
Many of these cell towers were on top of buildings, but all these buildings have been wiped out because of typhoon. And so it's very difficult to establish a cellular network in the traditional sense. The involvement of Microsoft in the TV white space technology revolves around the use of a geolocational database. The distance that the TV white space spectrum can cover is much further than what you would have with traditional Wi-Fi or than you would have with cellular technology. By using TV white space technologies to throw that signal out further, as far as 3, 5, or 7 kilometers out, we can establish evacuation centers, we can establish connectivity centers such as this one, where the people can then come.
With TV white space, we are able to provide connectivity to relief workers who then use the technology to coordinate with their superiors, with their colleagues, with NGOs, with the World Food Program, with USAID.
I think one of the biggest things in a relief effort is not just food, but it's the outlook of a person. And communications with family, I think, is something that, you know, even food cannot answer sometimes.
So we are using it for emails and then Facebook networking so that we can disseminate all the information to the faculty and staff, to the parents, to the students.
Skype calls have been important in doing telemedicine, in trying to address very specific and esoteric medical cases in these earthquake-hit areas.
The TV white space was very useful because the augmented or the province, the workers or the social workers from the province have to assess the situation here in Tubigan. We used it to submit reports and then how many families are affected, then the goods, water, food, how much they will send here in Tubigan or in the entire Bohol.
We are having a very good partnership with Microsoft. We are grateful for the technology.
We're hoping that more people will start picking it up and doing it, an inexpensive way of actually answering the problem of connectivity in the countryside.
Located at the foothills of Mount Makiling, Los Baños, Laguna, is the Forest Products Research and Development Institute, or FPRDI, an agency under the Department of Science and Technology, or DOST. For almost 60 years now, FPRDI has been committed to finding and improving the uses of wood and non-wood products harvested from the Philippine forests and plantations. During the golden era of Philippine forestry in the 1960s through the mid-1970s, FPRDI's remarkable support to the large wood-based industries made it one of Asia's leading forestry research organizations. These industries included the country's top exporting sectors then: logs, lumber, pulp and paper, and veneer and plywood. In fact, FPRDI was the first agency to establish a pulp and paper research and training center in Southeast Asia. But the rapid destruction of the country's natural forest from the mid-1970s through the 1990s prompted FPRDI to refocus its research thrusts on industrial tree plantation species and non-wood forest products to expand the Philippines' raw materials for the forest-based industries. The main users of these resources, the furniture, handicraft, and builders' woodwork makers, remain among our country's major export earners. The new raw materials come from lesser-used tree species such as tuog and binwang. Industrial tree plantation species examples of which are gemelina and mahogany. Non-wood resources like bamboo, rattan, coconut, vines, and bast fibers, plus a wide range of native plants and agricultural wastes which are valued sources of fiber, resins, essential oils and incense, fuel, flavorings, shelter, furnishings, ornaments, and natural chemical products such as dyes, adhesives, finishes, and preservatives. Helping the forest-based industries means continuously finding ways to maximize usage of these alternative raw materials and processing them into high value-added products. Today, FPRDI is an ISO-accredited organization committed to its mandates of conducting research and development on wood and non-wood forest and related products, transferring technologies, and providing technical services and training on the processing and utilization of forest-based raw materials. To attain its vision of being a center of excellence in its field, FPRDI has put in place two technical divisions, the Materials Science Division, or MSD, and the Technology Innovation Division, or TID. With support from the Technical Services Division, or TSD, the Planning Staff, and the Finance and Administrative Division. MSD studies the inherent properties of wood and non-wood forest products, their anatomy and botanical classification, their physical, mechanical, and chemical properties, their durability against wood-destroying pests such as termites and fungi, and their structural properties, or how suitable they are as affordable and eco-friendly construction materials. On the other hand, TID aims to find ways to improve the inherent properties of wood and non-wood materials and convert them into higher value products using mechanical, thermal, and chemical processing. Mechanical processing includes sawmilling, drying, and machining. Chemical processing covers preservation and application of dyes and finishes. FPRDI also studies how to improve composites or panel products and how to generate solid, liquid, and gaseous fuels from agroforest wastes. To assist its clients compete better in the local and global markets, FPRDI likewise operates testing laboratories for furniture, pulp and paper, and plywood. The pulp and paper, veneer and plywood, and furniture testing labs are accredited under ISO 17025-2005. The physics and mechanics, chemistry and structural testing labs will also pursue accreditation by ISO. These testing services aim to assure its clients that their products meet international standards. To make sure that the fruits of its labor reach the forest-based communities and industries, FPRDI relies on its extension arm, the Technical Services Division, or TSD. TSD assesses the impact of FPRDI installed technologies on the adopters and other beneficiaries, facilitates, monitors, and evaluates the technical and financial assistance packages given to clients, including manpower training, establishes the financial and market viability of FPRDI technologies, helps researchers protect their intellectual properties, and packages FPRDI information for varied client groups. Indeed, since its founding in 1957, FPRDI has helped write one success story after another among many beneficiaries of its technical assistance. The Dumalinao, Zamboanga del Sur-based wood tech builders is among the latest adopters of FPRDI's Furnace Type Lumber Dryer, or FTLD. It first acquired a 25,000 board foot capacity FTLD in 2010, followed by a 40,000 board feet capacity unit in 2013 to meet the market demand for cone dried wood products in Cebu and Zamboanga. Soon to be built is another dryer to complement the first two. Today, 90% of the solid panel doors, moldings, lumber, and other KD wood products produced by its factory are shipped to Cebu, which used to be the company's source of the same products pre-FTLD. WoodTech Builders has evolved into a multi-million enterprise with an annual gross sales of 13 million pesos. The wooden pallet industry can benefit from the Institute's Furnace Type Heat Treatment Facility, or FHTF. This can provide the heat needed to kill insects and other pests infesting wood packaging materials, or WPMs, such as wooden pallets. WPMs made of unprocessed wood are vulnerable to pest attacks and can introduce and spread pests from one country to another. Compared with methyl bromide or MB fumigation, heat treatment using the FHTF is an ecologically safe way of obtaining the International Plant Protection Convention marks for WPMs. Heat treatment time is 5 hours, which will only cost 6 pesos and 68 centavos per pallet using a 10,000 board foot capacity FHTF, or 46% cheaper than MB fumigation. Meanwhile, the Ilocos Norte Electric Cooperative, or INEC, relies on FPRDI's High Pressure Sap Displacement, or HPSD, method to treat their poles on site. HPSD has shortened the waiting period for the poles, thus facilitating connection to the power grid in the province. With the available electricity, all barangays in Ilocos Norte now enjoy economic development and improved quality of life. The HPSD has also generated for INEC at least 22 million pesos in savings for pole treatment. In the next 5 years, FPRDI will focus on the following goals: to develop more efficient cone dryers, to find ways to maximize the use of every part of the bamboo, to process natural rubber exudates and old rubber trees into high-value products, to find more profitable ways of using industrial tree plantation species, to optimize the use of abaca fiber for paper and other high-end products, and to help reduce poverty among the forest-based communities and industry workers. As FPRDI moves towards its 60th year, the hurdles confronting the Institute and its clients are many and daunting. The local forest industries are bogged down by fluctuating global economies, in addition to the usual concerns: limited supply of raw materials and tough competition from neighboring Asian countries. The men and women of FPRDI, however, choose to see these problems as opportunities for growth. All the setbacks notwithstanding, the Philippines remains one of the most biodiverse countries in the world in terms of non-wood forest products. Filipino craftsmen continue to shine worldwide for their creativity, innovativeness, and skilled workmanship. These, plus other indicators, tell us that the forest-based industries remain viable and still have a lot of room to grow. And for as long as they need us, we at FPRDI, with the help of our friends, are committed to bringing viable solutions to our clients in the forest-based industries, communities, and the public.
In this modern day and age, fashion designers and consumers alike are choosing to go natural. With increasing environment protection awareness, the fashion industry turns to sustainable eco-clothing, joining global efforts to conserve and preserve. With the increasing demand for eco-friendly products, the industry is in constant search for more innovative materials. At the forefront of textile research and development in the country, the Philippine Textile Research Institute, or PTRI, is actively supporting our local textile and allied industries carve a niche in the global market through the use of our country's rich indigenous resources and the development of technical competence in textile production and quality assurance, evident in the on-ground technology transfer projects conducted in several regions of the country. PTRI aims to redefine and set the standard for world-class authentic Philippine fashion using our very own tropical fibers and natural dyes, as well as locally developed textile technologies and cultural traditions in weaving. An agency under the Department of Science and Technology, PTRI facilities are housed within a 2-hectare lot inside the DOST complex in Bicutan, Taguig City. The compound has a complete line of textile testing equipment and machineries for cotton, silk, and indigenous fiber processing, and facilities for spinning, weaving, and finishing. Its laboratories for physical and chemical testing of textiles and related materials are ISO IEC 17025 accredited. PTRI researchers, chemists, and fabric specialists have gained trainings, accreditations,
and certifications from various learning institutes and programs in Japan, South Korea, India, the United Kingdom,
and Australia,
among others.
CTRI has established linkages with various government offices, such as
Department of Trade and Industry, Department of Agriculture,
Department of Environment and Natural Resources,
and the Department of Public Works and Highways, as well as with the private sector and the academe.
Technology transfer have two primary goals: employment generation and production efficiency. To achieve these, the Institute's Technology Transfer Program concentrates on the following activities: industry skills training on various textile technologies, from spinning, weaving, dyeing, and on-the-job training for students, and the provision of a technology business incubator. PTRI also offers services responding to their dynamic development requirements, including basic technical services on physical and chemical testing, textile processing and finishing, contract research, and science and technology consultancy. Professionals, students, representatives from both the private and the public sector, and other interested parties may also avail of tours of the Institute's various testing facilities and research laboratory. Through the judicious use of indigenous materials, otherwise considered as agricultural wastes, PTRI researchers were bestowed the Pag-asa Award during the 2011 Civil Service Commission search for outstanding public officials and employees. Natural dyes are making a colorful splash in the international world of fashion. This trend makes the PTRI's Natural Dyes R&D program a bright area in our country's economy. Taking advantage of our rich natural resources, this program uses dye-yielding plants used to produce natural dyes in crude, paste, and powder forms. PTRI has identified and established 75 plant dye sources compiled into a two-volume compendium, the Gambol. Less technical but also a fascinating reference on our natural dyes is the coffee table book, Bahaghari, The Colors of the Philippines. Under the program, PTRI provided natural dyed barong to the SNT ministers of the ASEAN and naturally dyed gowns for the Miss Earth finalists. PTRI is actively in search of technologies to add value to our natural fibers, embarking on five new R&D programs, namely bio-nanofiber and composite technologies, natural nano-dyes and pigment technologies, nano-functional and nano-composite finishing technologies, biofunctional materials and textile technologies, and green colorants materials and processing technologies. Using these advanced textile technologies, including nanotechnology for the development of intelligent and smart textiles, to widen potential uses of textiles not only for apparels but also for industrial, medical, and cosmetic purposes. Responding to the specialized needs of garment companies and fashion designers, PTRI will also delve on customized processing of yarns and fabrics tailored fit to suit their particular requirements. The Institute's legacy on Philippine tropical fabrics, natural dyes, silkworm breeding, and textile development technologies and current research endeavors provides the key to a world of possibilities, not only for the fabric industry, but for other industries that may benefit from it, as PTRI paves the way to discover new, better, and alternative sources of natural fibers and dyes. A light of hope now sparks for an empowered Philippine textile industry. Once again, our country is about to lead the whole ASEAN region to reach further horizons. And every farmer, every weaver, every Filipino is soon to witness not only a revived fabric industry, but a flourishing textile economy. The Philippine Textile Research Institute, weaving the Filipino dream, clothing the Filipino spirit.
Life is good and so is the morning. Happiness is just around the corner. Kaya always remember to smile. And speaking of smile and happiness, isang celebration ang hatid namin sa inyo ngayon because today is a grand and special day. Mga ka-forever, welcome to DOSTv's 100th episode. Kay bilis nga naman talaga ng panahon, our show was launched last May 30, 2016 at after 100 days, magkakasama pa rin tayo. From the bottom of our hearts, we would like to thank you. Hindi po namin ma-achieve ang milestone na ito kung hindi dahil sa walang sawang pagsuporta ninyo. Ako po si Jel Miranda, ang inyong ka-online at ka-forever. We welcome you to DOSTv, your most comprehensive real-time authority on the latest weather updates. Dahil weather lang ang laging nandyan, taga-Romano tag-ulan, hindi nang iiwan kahit sino ka man. Remember that folks, it's DOSTv reporting from the Department of Science and Technology in Bicutan, Taguig City. Ang DOSTv ay mapapanood ninyo Mondays to Fridays, 11 a.m. to 12 noon. Dito lang sa www.dostv.ph. At live na rin po tayo sa Facebook at facebook.com/dostvph. Kaya makisabay na rin sa live streaming namin. At since ika-100 episode namin ito, we want to give you the best, something important, and who else to make this celebration perfect but the DOST Secretary himself, Secretary Fortunato Dela Peña. We are deeply honored na pinaunlakan niya tayo sa ating special day, mga ka-forever. I am quite excited to hear his plans for DOST in the next few years. Minsan lang ito mangyayari, kaya don't miss this chance to hear great words from a well-admired leader and a public servant. Kaya naman mag-login na kayo at tutok lang. Pero bago ang lahat ng yan, alamin muna natin ang magiging lagay ng panahon for today. Heto ng ating Pag-asa correspondent para sa ating ulat panahon.
Thank you, Ms. Jel. Good morning sa iyo. Good morning din sa ating mga viewers ng DOSTV. Sa ngayon po yung binabantayan natin na si Bagyong Karen with international name na Sarika ay namataan kaninang alas 7 ng umaga sa layong 295 kilometers east-northeast ng Viracatanduanes. Dahil po ito ay tropical storm na, ito ay may taglay na hangin na 75 kilometers per hour malapit sa gitna at may pagbugso naman na umaabot sa 95 kilometers per hour. Sa ngayon po, kumikilos pa rin ito pa west-northwest sa bilis na 13 kilometers per hour. At base po sa latest track ng Pag-asa, base po dun sa ating latest track, kung mapapansin natin, kaninang madaling araw ay namata nito sa east ng Catanduanes. Then within the next 24 hours, possible na mag-intensify pa ito bilang isang severe tropical storm. At pinakamalapit ito sa areas ng Bicol, lalo na dito sa Catanduanes. So possible po na mag-raise tayo sa Catanduanes ng signal number 3 sa mga susunod na araw. Samantala, 48 hours or sa araw po ng Linggo ng madaling araw, nasa paligid na ito ng Aurora, Quezon Province, and Bicol Region area. So malamang po, mayroon na ring warning signal doon sa mga nasabi kong lugar, signal numbers 2 or 3. At pagdating po ng hapon or tanghali ng Sunday, inaasahang magla-landfall itong si Bagyong Karen sa areas ng Northern Quezon or Aurora. At after that, magla-landfall po ito or dadaan ito sa malaking bahagi ng Northern and Central Luzon, particularly more probably dito po sa may Nueva Vizcaya, Nueva Ecija area, ngayon din sa Benguet and Pangasinan, Tarlac area, at pinakamababa na po sa Northern Zambales. Lalabas ito sa ganap na madaling araw ng October 17 or Monday, kung saan inaasahang pagdating ng gabi naman ng Monday ay nasa labas nito ng Philippine Area of Responsibility bilang isang typhoon. Sa ngayon po, nakataas ang Tropical Cyclone Warning Signal number 2 sa Catanduanes at Signal number 1 naman po sa Polillo Island sa Northern Quezon. Ganyan din po sa Southern Quezon, Camarines Norte, Camarines Sur, ganyan din sa Albay, Sorsogon, at sa Northern Samar, meron din po tayong signal number 1. Ngayon, alamin naman po natin kung ano nga ba ang naghihintay na panahon sa mga kababayan natin sa Luzon within the next 24 hours. Kung mapapansin po natin dito sa may parting Ilocos Region and Cordillera Administrative Region, maganda pa naman ang panahon sa ngayon at minsan na nagiging bahagyang maulap ang kalangitan. Aasahan din nila yung mga isolated rain showers or thunderstorms. Pagdating naman po dito sa Cagayan Valley, dahil ito'y malapit na pinakamalapit dun sa bagyo pagdating sa Northern Luzon, gayon din po sa Central Luzon at dito rin po sa Metro Manila, gayon din sa mga lalawigan ng Cavite, Laguna, Batangas, and Rizal, at dito rin sa Mimaropa meron tayong asahang mahina hanggang katamtamang mga pag-ulan at pagkidlat pagkulog dahil po yan sa outer ring bands nitong si Bagyong Karen. Dito naman po sa mga kababayan natin sa Quezon, kung saan nakataas nga ang signal number 1, gayon din sa Bicol region except sa Catanduanes, makakaranas naman ng rains with gusty winds. Ibig sabihin, minsan lumalakas yung mga ulan at meron ding hangin yung maabot from 30 to 60 kilometers per hour sa susunod na 24 to 36 hours. And then finally, pagdating po dito sa Catanduanes, makakaranas na sila sa susunod na 24 oras ng masungit na panahon dahil nga nakataas doon ang Tropical Cyclone Warning Signal number 1. So ibig sabihin, malakas na ulan na may kasamang hangin umaabot from 61 to 95 kilometers per hour at possible din ng storm surge lalo na po sa malapit sa mga coastal areas. Dumako naman po tayo sa ating temperature range for Luzon. Ngayong araw sa Metro Manila, maglalaro po ang temperatura mula 24 hanggang 31 degrees Celsius. Dito naman sa Baguio City, 16 hanggang 23 degrees Celsius. Sa Tagaytay City naman, 22 hanggang 29 degrees Celsius. And then finally, sa Puerto Princesa sa Palawan, 25 hanggang 32 degrees Celsius. Dumako naman po tayo sa ating weather for Visayas and Mindanao. Base po sa ating latest image, kung mapapansin natin, nakakonsentrate yung cloudiness nitong si Bagyong Karen dito sa Northern Samar, kung saan nakataas nga doon ang Tropical Cyclone Warning Signal number 1. Makakaranas sila ng malalakas sa paulan at hanging umaabot from 30 to 60 kilometers per hour. Dito naman po sa natitirang bahagi ng Samar, particularly sa Samar Province and sa Eastern Samar, ay makakaranas naman sila ng moderate, occasionally heavy ng mga pagulan, which is possible na magdulot ng flash floods and landslides. Habang sa natitirang bahagi ng Visayas, ay asa naman natin ang mahina hanggang katamtamang mga pagulan within the next 24 hours na may kasamang pagkidlat pagkulog. Pagdating po dito sa Mindanao, apektado pa rin ang northern part or northern regions, kabilang ng Zamboanga Peninsula, Northern Mindanao, and Caraga Region. So makakaasa din sila ng mahina hanggang katamtamang pagulan at pagkidlat pagkulog. And then finally, sa regions naman ng ARMM, gayon din sa Soxargen and Davao Region, ay makakaranas naman sila ngayon ng magandang panahon. Most of the day po yan, so ibig sabihin magiging mainit pagdating ng tanghali. At aasahan pa rin nila yung mga panandaliang buhos ng ulan or pulupulong pagkilat pagkulog sa hapon or sa gabi. Dumako naman po tayo sa ating temperature range for Visayas and Mindanao. Kung mapapansin po natin, mas bumaba ng bahagya ang temperatura dito sa Metro Cebu, 25 hanggang 31 degrees Celsius lamang. Dito naman sa Iloilo, 25 hanggang 32 degrees. Pinakamainit sa ngayon sa Metro Davao, 25 hanggang 33 degrees Celsius. And then finally, sa Zamboanga City, 24 hanggang 31 degrees Celsius. Dahil po sa epekto ni Bagyong Karen, meron din po tayong gale warning dun sa mga nabanggit kong lugar na may warning signal at dun din sa ibang lugar, kabilang na nga ang Aurora, gayon din ang mga baybayin ng Quezon, kabilang na ang Polillo Island, Camarines Provinces, baybayin ng Catanduanes, Albay and Sorsogon, hanggang dito po sa Northern and Eastern Samar, meron po tayong gale warning. Ibig sabihin, matataas ang mga pag-alon doon, umaabot from 3.4 hanggang 4.5 meters. So pinagbabawalan na po na pumalaot doon ang mga kababayan natin na mangingisda at yung may maliliit na sasakyang pandagat. And actually, hanggang sa weekend, inaasahan pa rin natin na bawal pumalaot doon dahil mapanganib ang mga pag-alon. Ngayon po, bukod sa Bagyong Karen, meron pa rin po tayong minomonitor na dalawang weather system sa labas ng ating Philippine Area of Responsibility. Una na po dyan, itong tropical depression sa labas ng PAR. Ito ay nasa vicinity na ng Central Vietnam at inaasahan papasok pa patungo sa mga bansang Laos at dito rin po sa western or eastern section ng Thailand at hindi na inaasahan makakaapekto sa ating bansa. Yung isa naman po, low pressure area na nasa malayong part ng Mindanao, more than 2,000 kilometers away, possible po siya na mag-intensify bilang isang tropical depression within the next 24 hours. Pero wala pa rin po itong inaasahang direktang epekto sa ating bansa. Ang projection po natin dito, mag-intensify pa ito, possible na mag-isang type nito at papangalanan po natin ito na Lawin pagpasok niya sa ating Philippine Area of Responsibility at ang target po na entry niya sa PAR ay sa araw po ng Martes. Dumako naman po tayo sa ating sunset and sunrise. Si Haring Araw ay lulubog mamayang 5:37 ng hapon at muli itong sisikat bukas sa ganap na 5:47 ng umaga. At mula pa rin dito sa Weather Forecasting Center ng DOST Pag-asa, ako po si Benison Estareja, reporting for DOSTv.
wraparound exclusive content na dito nyo lang sa DOSTv makikita, here's our flood and water level advisory.
Maraming salamat, Jel, at maganda ang umaga sa iyo at sa ating mga taga-subaybay ng DOSTV. Dam update po tayo sa mga minomonitor natin dams dito sa Luzon. Umpisan po natin dito sa Angat Dam. Sa kasalukuyan, ang elevation niya is 195.93 meters. Bahagya po itong tumaas ng 38 centimeters. Base po doon sa observation namin, kahapon ng alas 6 ng umaga hanggang alas 6 ng umaga ngayon. And kailangan pa rin niya ng at least 14 meters para maabot niya yung 210 meters elevation na spilling level. Or at least 510 millimeters of rainfall para ma-reach niya yung 210 meters na spilling level. Samantalan dito sa Pantabangan Dam, current elevation niya is 197.21 meters. Bahagya po itong tumaas ng 21 centimeter, yung po yung observation namin na 24 hours. And then, kailangan pa rin niya ng at least 1,300 millimeters or at least 19 meters para ma-reach niya yung spilling level na 216 meters. Samantalan dito sa San Roque Dam, ang current elevation niya is 274.21 meters. Tumaas po ito ng 78 centimeter. And kailangan pa rin niya ng 75 millimeters or 5.79 meters para ma-reach niya yung spilling level. Samantalang dito sa Magat Dam, current elevation niya is 187.92. Bahagya po itong tumaas ng 17 centimeter and kailangan pa rin ng at least 30 millimeters of rainfall or mahigit 2 metro na lang ang kailangan nito para ma-reach niya yung spilling level. And naka-red alert po tayo dito sa Magat Dam, so pinapayuhan natin yung mga nakatira along Magat River na medyo maging alerto sa ngayon dahil anytime tomorrow or Sunday, baka mapuno itong Magat Dam and mag-release ng tubig. Samantala, mayroon po tayong Initial General Flood Advisory dito po sa mga lugar ng Central Luzon, Calabarzon, Mimaropa, Bicol Region, and then Western Visayas, Central Visayas, Eastern Visayas, and Caraga Region. So, yung mga nabanggit pong lugar, pinapayuhan natin na maging alerto at mag-ingat po dahil yung mga, lalong-lalo na yung mga nakatira po sa malapit sa bundok, dulot po ng malalakas na mga pag-ulan sa pag-uho po ng lupa dahil lumalambot po yung lupa pagpatuloy yung mga pag-ulan. And then, yung mga nakatira po malapit sa ilog, pinapayuhan natin na maging alerto rin dahil po sa pagtaas ng tubig sa ilog, baka umapaw po ito. So, yan muna ang update, Jel, at mula pa rin dito sa Pag-asa Flood Forecasting Center, Richard Orendain, nag-uulat.
Namin magiging madalina dahil hindi na po kami mahihirapan na kuha ng bawat gamit, kundi sabay-sabay na po nandyan na hindi na kami, kung toxic ang aming pasyente, yung aming papaanakin, hindi na po kami
tatakbo-takbong kukunin yung BP, kukunin yung IPHT niya dahil nandyan na po lahat sa RX box. Nung wala pa po yung RX box tsaka cheat sa amin, mabagal po yung proseso ng pag-a-admit namin kasi po kailangan pa po namin hanapin yung mga charts nila. Minsan po naglo-lost file pa po kami. Nung dumating na po yung RX box tsaka cheat dito sa amin, mas bumilis, mas gumaan, tapos naging kampante na po kami sa mga serbisyong pangkalusugan po namin.
Nandun na yan, di na kami mahihirapan sa paggawa ng report. Naka-record na sila lahat, di na kami magbuklat-buklat, hahanapin pa yung mga services na nai-offer namin sa mga patient, tapos liligumin namin sa after the end of the month, itatali namin yon, diyan, titingnan lang namin, bubuksan lang namin, tali na siya.
Sinasabi ni midwife na tumataas baba yung ano mo, yung blood pressure mo, kaya ano, hindi ko kakayanin, baka kung ano mangyari sa inyong dalawa ng babies. Kung wala yung kagamitan na yun, yung RX box, hindi ko malalaman kung buhay pa kami ng anak ko ngayon kasi nanganganib na nga yung buhay namin, tapos hindi pa namin alam kung okay ba yung bata or okay ba yung blood pressure ko, baka isa sa amin ang nawala ngayon.
Is the number of years in century. 100 is also the record of most number of points scored in one NBA game by a single player. And 100 is the number of our episode for today. At dahil dyan, we have a special and distinguished guest for today. Our guest is a Filipino engineer, professor, and a civil servant. He started his career at UP Diliman when he joined the faculty of the UP College of Engineering. He was a research assistant of the university and the first editor of the Philippine Engineering Journal, and later on chaired its Department of Industrial Engineering and Operations Research. Moreover, he was appointed as director of UP's Institute for Small Scale Industries and as a vice president for planning and development of the entire University of the Philippines system. He then served as president of the Philippine Association for the Advancement of Science and Technology since 2011 and had been undersecretary of the DOST under two previous administrations. He is also former chairman of the United Nations Commission on Science and Technology for Development. And of course, currently, he is the Secretary of Department of Science and Technology. Mga ka-forever, let us all welcome, walang iba, Secretary Fortunato T. Dela Peña. Sir, good morning and welcome sa DOSTv. Thank you for gracing our 100th episode for today. Pero bago ang lahat, syempre mas gusto muna namin kayong kilalanin, sino ba talaga si Fortunato Dela Peña behind your success or behind your profession?
Eh, siguro ang una ko munang babanggitin ay yung aking background as a professional. So you have already mentioned in your introduction that I am an engineer. I am a chemical engineer and an industrial engineer also at the same time. And I have actually spent 43 years teaching at the UP College of Engineering, even during the time that I have been seconded to the Department of Science and Technology. I have been seconded to this department for three times before this current assignment. The first one in 1982 to 84 to head the planning service. The second one in 1989 to 1991 to head the newly established Technology Application and Promotion Institute. And then the last one was from 2001 until 2014 when I was the Undersecretary of DOST. Now, maybe, of course, in addition, I am a father, a grandfather, okay? I have, my wife is a nurse, formerly at the UP Infirmary, and actually, she is also my neighbor. We grew up together.
Wow! And, so, kabata niyo siya, sir?
Kabata ko siya. We were in the same school bus.
Okay.
And then we have, of course, five children, four boys and one girl. They are now all on their own as professionals or businessmen. And yun nga, I have four grandchildren. Now, I retired in 2014 as undersecretary. And during the period of my retirement, I continued teaching at UP and also did some consulting work. So until, of course, I was surprised that I was called again to serve last
Ibig sabihin, kailangan pa kayo. Kahit retired na si sir, di ba patuloy pa rin yung serbisyo na ibibigay ninyo? Mm-hmm. Pero kayo talaga, family man kayo.
Eh, siyempre.
Oo, kita natin, di ba? Talagang parang na-imagine ko na you are very happily married, di ba? Pero ang science talaga, sir, nasa dugo niyo na. Ibig sabihin, bata pa lang kayo, ang interest niyo ba talaga, eh, gusto kong tahaking career later on ang science and technology?
Actually, nung ako ay bata, gusto kong maging doktor.
Mm-hmm.
Oo. Ngayon, tatlo lang kami magkakapatid. Meron akong dalawang ate,
okay.
No, ako lang ang lalaki, and then medyo malaki ang agwat namin. And when they were already graduated, that was the time I entered college, and sabi nila, oh, mas maganda kung mag-engineering ka, tal magaling ka naman sa mathematics. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed math during my elementary and high school days. So I took up engineering, but originally talaga sabi ko gusto kong mag-doktor.
So wala na, sabihin na nabura na lahat ng isipan.
Nabura na yun, oo. Anyway, kung saan mga anak nag-doktor, okay na rin yun. dalawa.
Okay, so ang first niyong tinay, industrial?
Chemical. Engineering, oo. And then I took up my graduate degree in industrial engineering.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so ngayon, sabi mo nga, being a undersecretary with the previous administration, eto, napili pa rin kayo as appointing ngayon. as DOST Secretary, anong unang naramdaman ninyo nung tinawagan kayo agad na ito, bibili ko sa yung posisyon?
Well, actually, hindi naman sinabi agad na gano'n. My CV was requested by a good friend of mine, and I was told that if I will be chosen, I must be ready to say yes. Mm-hmm. In other words, I was told, think about it before you submit your CV. Mm-hmm. Be sure that you will accept when you are chosen, mm-hmm. because there is a committee pa rin siguro. And so when I was called, then there is no other way but to accept it. And even if it is difficult living in retirement where you are very relaxed, you know, so I thought that maybe I can still serve.
Mm-hmm. At may purpose pa talaga kayo. Mm-hmm. At ngayon nga, syempre, kasabay ng ika-100 ninyong panunungkulan bilang secretary, syempre, 100 episode din po ng DOSTv. At ipapasalamin kami dahil, syempre, of course, sa support na binibigay po ninyo. Mm-hmm. Pero ano bang next plan for DOSTv?
Well, kung ako tatanungin, mm-hmm. gusto kong maging totoong TV siya. In the sense na, yung talagang mapapanood mo sa regular channel. I really don't know what will be the mechanics or the policy, because we have a government channel, whether they will allow another government agency. For me, maybe it's not necessarily that it will be devoted 100% to science and technology, but there are certain related services. For example, if a particular TV station can be devoted to, let's say, science, technology, education, yes. agriculture, yung mga ganun.
Sama-sama na, sir.
Sama-sama sila. So, that this will be, I think, very, very useful and educational to our citizens.
Mm-hmm. Tama. Kasi nga, sabi nga natin dito, everyday ang episode namin, lahat kami in all support sa lahat ng aspeto, science man yan, agriculture, di ba? Yes. Kumbaga, ang link natin, connect, magkaka-connect pa rin naman yan, di ba, sir?
Basta kung paano magagamit sa buhay.
Pero ngayon, kayo, kamusta yung inyong ika-100 day nyo as a secretary?
Ay, siyempre, yung first 100 days was a time for adjustment. Okay. Even if I came from the OST, mm-hmm. also, you have to adjust. For one, sabi nga nila, the buck stops at you. So, wala ka nang pwedeng takbuhan iba pa. Siyempre, the president would like you to settle everything at your level, you know. But from time to time, we have to inform him. Now, I think what is good at the DOST is that people are very professional, and I think that is one good thing about working for this agency.
Meron pa bang adjustment in a way? Kasi syempre nag-alala rin kayo dito sa department na ito. Mm-hmm. And then later on kayo na
yun. Of course, there is adjustment because before you have a very specialized area to focus on. So for example, if you are undersecretary for R&D, then you just look at R&D. If you are undersecretary for services, then you just look at services. But this time you cover everything. Of course, you have people working for you, but still, you have to be aware of everything that is happening.
And every day, meron challenges.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Paano niyo na-handle yung stress and pressure?
I just say, dadating na rin ang gabi. Tutulog na lang ako.
Para pagising mo, bago umaga
na naman. Bago stress na naman.
Oo. Pero meron ba kayo, sir, kumbaga, guiding policy na sinusunod, kung meron man ba?
Una-una, dapat we will stick to the truth, lahat tayo, ano? Wala dapat hindi totoo, okay? Pangalawa, I believe in engaging the constituents, the people in the organization in making important decisions, okay? And siguro pangatlo, ako yung taong I feel successful if the people under me are successful. So in other words, that is actually the philosophy of a teacher.
Yes.
That you want to see the people you are teaching to be successful. Mm-hmm. If they're successful, that is a measure of my success.
Mm-hmm. Parang ano ba yun? Parang forte niyo ba yun, sir, talaga? Siyempre, in a way, kayo ay isang professor din.
Teacher,
kayo ang isang guro. Mm-hmm. Sanay na kayong humarap sa mga tao, sa mga estudyante, mm-hmm. may tuturo kayo. At ngayon, namumuno kayo sa DOST.
Mm-hmm.
madali na ba? Parang kahit papaano, meron na kayong, hindi naman template, pero in a way, kaya nyo nang harapin.
Oh, siguro.
In everyday life.
Eh, siguro, bunga na rin yun ng, ano, ng experience at saka ikaw nga, ng edad.
Ano niyo, sir? Pag nalaman niyo edad ni sir, parang wala. Hindi mo makikita. Parang napaka-relax niyo nga po eh. Parang kayang-kayang harapin ng different stress sa ating ano, pang-araw-araw ng buhay. Sa DOST, ano yung pinaka, sa ngayon po, ang focus ng inyong trabaho or dapat natin tutukan?
Well, of course, may mandato kasi ang DOST. Mm-hmm. Nandyan yung aming role to coordinate and support research and development.
Okay.
Nandiyan yung role namin to see to it that the technologies are utilized for the good of the people. Nandiyan yung aming mandate to provide services, scientific and technological services. And then, of course, yung ating mandate to develop people in the areas of science and technology. So, these are still our main mandates, but maybe in terms of having priorities, this is where our, shall we say, the thinking of our leader, yung kanyang agenda will come in. So, when, for example, the president says that he would like to promote competitiveness, so we talk of that as both the competitive of our industries, the competitiveness of our people, and even the competitiveness of our institutions, no? So we do our programs in relation to that, so research and development that can lead to competitiveness, services that can lead to competitiveness, development of people. Then, of course, it will be, shall we say, unfortunate if we will not maximize the results of the research and development that we'll be doing. So, my focus really is how to maximize the utilization of these outputs of research and development, because we invested money in this. So, we try to relate to other line agencies so that they can roll out our technologies. We relate to the business sector because they will be able to identify areas of opportunities. And we also relate with our communities, our LGUs, because these are the people that we want to serve. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, yung facilities, I think we really have to look forward to, shall we say, being at par with the rest of the world, you know. And we really have to invest, and that is, of course, the thing that I am eyeing at. The leaders are quite supportive of the idea of science and technology being strengthened, but we really have to work it out and see to it that we can absorb whatever resources are given to us. And syempre, in terms of developing our human resources, we really have to move up and beyond the high school, beyond the baccalaureate, we really have to push for more people getting advanced degrees, because this is where the specialization takes place, and this is where the competitiveness and the competitiveness will come in.
Mm-hmm. At sa ngayon nga, nakikita natin different innovations, different projects ang naipatutupad ngayon.
But more importantly, I think we take the cue from the pronouncements of the president that he would like to see the regions develop, developing faster, that he would like to see a more equitable distribution of development, and that he would like government to really serve people. So that is our guide in developing our programs, in expanding our programs, in thinking of new programs.
Mm-hmm. At lalo na, sir, syempre yung mga nasa liblib na lugar, paano natin ipapabot sa kanila yung servisyo?
Well, the service has to be hands-on, no? And maybe it is quite timely that last Monday I was in a town in Cebu, Dalaguete, you know, and it is called the summer capital of Cebu because it's high elevation, and the people in many of the barangays are in vegetable production. Yes. So you can see our fellow Filipinos there, they are doing hard work, really hard work producing this vegetables, and but they need a lot of support also because they are subject to a lot of shall we say stresses. Mm-hmm. The environment, the climate, the limitations in water, etc. I think technology can help them a lot, and I would prefer going to these places and helping people who you see are really trying their best to be productive.
Natutulog pa kayo, sir? Parang ang dami yung sinusuyod na bayan, hindi ba? Bawat hindi siya kailangan.
Well,
imagine ang DOST kasi, sir, ang daming agencies under your department.
And the regional offices, mm-hmm. for the country is big also, mm-hmm. and we have a big population.
Yes.
So, just balancing your time.
Mm-hmm. At kailangan monitor matutukan. Mm-hmm. Siyempre, meron pa kayong 6 years eh, di ba? Tatambay pa natin 6 na taon pa yung 6 na taon.
Huwag muna natin pag-usapan yun.
Huwag mo muna, utay-utay. Oh, pero may mga, syempre, mga future plans pa tayo under
yes, oh.
Your administration. Ano po yun?
Definitely nga ito. We will have to invest more into research and development.
Okay.
But we have already identified yung mga priorities. For example, in the area of health, importante na matap natin yung ating biodiversity to be able to develop and discover new drugs, okay? Nandiyan din yung kailangan nating ma-address yung mga problema sa diseases, lalo na yung diagnosis, kung ano yung mga pwedeng ma-develop na kits to diagnose quickly. And of course, I think we really have to use local technology also in coming up with biomedical equipment and facilities because they are very expensive, and that's one of the reasons why you don't see them in the rural areas. Now, the other thing, of course, is in the industrial and energy side. And here, we really have to see to it that our research and development will help our manufacturing and agricultural sector in their production. It has always been said that our productivity is low compared to our other neighbors of comparable size. And we really have to do R&D, which are commodity specific, okay, to see to it that they produce higher yields. Now, in terms of competitiveness, I think there are certain areas which we have already started in the previous administrations. For example, now countries are looking at space technology.
Yes.
Okay, and we see the benefits out of space technologies, and so we will continue the research in these areas. Okay, of course, and we just want to see that there is an appropriate institutional infrastructure. We look into, for example, the field of artificial intelligence, which is now of course the eating,
mm-hmm.
but I am happy to say that as early as 1985 when I was the planning officer, uh-huh. we already wrote in our plan research in artificial intelligence.
Kaya,
1985. Yes, because our IT people, mm-hmm. Of course combined mm-hmm. with the other disciplines can do this, no? Importante lang we have set our directions and our targets. And I think we also look at the aspect of human security in all aspects. So there is a lot of research that can be done in this area.
Mm-hmm. So sa ngayon, sir, kayo ba, in your opinion, in your personal point, kailangan ba natin ng ibang bansa when it comes to pangangailangan pa natin siguro sa science and technology para mas makaunod pa natin
kasi
sa science and
technology? Kasi yung iba namang mga areas, okay, hindi mo na kailangan i-rediscover.
Okay.
No? Meron lang mga nagawa sa ibang bansa, and you just have to start from what is already known.
Mm-hmm.
No? And I think that is what we are doing, you know, in terms of the what we call the technologies that cut across all sectors, whether it is genomics, okay, whether it is nanotechnology, or whether it is information technology, we don't have to rediscover everything.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there are already good things that have been developed, and we start from there. Okay, but we have to develop our own capabilities.
Mm-hmm. So ngayon, sir, next, siguro in few years, or sabihin natin next year, 2 years from now, ano pa yung mga plano natin? Kaya na ba natin mailan sa kanila ngayon?
Well, yun na yung mga sinasabi ko kanina, and I think detalye na lang kung ano yung mga research and development na gagawin. Unang-una, talagang kailangan ma-save natin yung mga commodities natin na nasa subject sa stress because of so many changes in the environment. Nandiyan na yung mga new diseases that are coming up because of the change in climate.
Yes.
Nandiyan na yung, of course, the change in climate that results in the change of weather patterns and that affects our productivity also. And of course, I think on the other hand, there are certain things that will be shaped by policy, not necessarily within the DOST, because there are certain policies in the different line agencies that will really affect the productivity in that sector. But we are willing to help in the technology part.
Okay. Ano yung pinaka-main goal ni sir hanggang sa matapos sa inyong demo?
Well, ang main goal ko talaga ay makita na mayroong mga breakthroughs na na-recognize internationally na contribution ng Pilipinas. Pangalawa, gusto ko ding makita na ang mga Filipino scientists ay nire-recognize. Ano? Kuminsan nga dito pa rin sa ating bansa, kailangan pa din silang ma-recognize, di ba?
Yes.
Kuminsan ang mga awards na naibibigay, nandung may binigay sa mga nasa creative arts,
yes,
nasa literature, pero I think the scientists deserve to be recognized, okay? And not only here, but also internationally. They can only be recognized, of course, if they produce, okay, breakthroughs that will add knowledge. And I would like to see our facilities to be much improved. And lastly, the working conditions of scientists also be improved.
Ayan, talaga naman, ang mga scientists, hindi matatawaran ang husay at galing. Sabi nyo nga, ako meron ibang larangan o ibang field, nabibigyan o kumbaga na-acknowledge sila. Why not itong mga scientists natin na namuhunan din ang kanilang husay at talino, hindi ba? Na dapat na nabibigyan ng pagkilala.
Yes,
siyempre sir, ito tanong lang naman. Ang DOSTv, siyempre, ang DOSTv, una-una, nagpapasalamat din kami dahil part ng Department of Science and Technology, itong pagbibigay namin ng servisyo. Any future plans? Sabi nyo kanina, gusto nyo makita kami sa TV. Kami rin, lumabas sa TV. Pero gaano pa katagal? Do you have any future plan for DOSTv?
Hindi. Kailangan umpisahan na ngayon ng groundwork. No?
Okay.
Kasi ang isang yun namang budget aspects, basta maliwanag ang policy ng gobyerno, mas madaling trabahuhin. Ano? Makikita naman ang halimbawa ng DBM o ng presidente na ito talaga mahalaga. Hindi naman tayo pagdadamutan ng resources. But ang mahalaga ay ito ba ay naaayon sa policy. Halimbawa, kung ang policy ay isa lang ang government station, then we have to work closely with the with the government station and see how we can fit in. Kung allowed naman na magkaroon ng iba, then we can probably even work together with other agencies na eka nga eh developmental ang trabaho. Oo, and then we can focus ourselves. Of course, it may be different in terms of income generation. Okay, kasi sa developmental, it's more of a service.
Yes.
Na, kesa dun sa mga entertainment.
Yes, talaga naman. At syempre dito, makikita ninyo sa araw-araw namin pagbibigay sa inyo ng programa, nakasuporta kami in different agencies, in different department of the government, and nasa DOSTv. At sana nga magtuloy-tuloy pa itong pagbibigay namin sa inyo ng magagandang servisyo. Any future, any upcoming projects, sir, na pwede
natin? Hindi. Actually, naghanda ako kasi 100 days ang ating
yes, sir.
Usapan. So, naglista rin ako dito, no? Ano ba yung mga highlights of first 100 days?
Yes.
Ano? Siguro, ililitan niya ko na lang ang mabilis. Ano? So, as far as the physical aspects are concerned, we were able to install 271 new hydrometeorological stations, okay? And then we have been able to distribute to 99 local government units their localized flood and hazard maps, okay, as a project of the LIDAR program. And then as far as weather pag-asa is concerned, the latest installation was the Zamboanga Doppler radar station, which was completed during the last 100 days. During the last 100 days also, we were able to operationalize three food innovation centers one in Iloilo, one in Guimaras, and one in Cebu. And of course, we marked the 1,000 Starbucks installation in Calawan, Laguna. That was last 2 weeks ago. And in as far as the Small Enterprise Technology Upgrading Program is concerned, during the last 100 days, we were able to enable 94 enterprises to procure their hardware for improvement of technology and productivity. And that amounted to about 137 million. Mm-hmm. More importantly, as important also is the opening of two new Philippine Science High School campuses. Last August 8, we opened the 15th campus, the Philippine Science High School in Mimaropa, in Ojongan, Roblon. And in on August 15, we opened the Sabuanga Peninsula Regional Campus of the Philippine Science High School. That is the 16th campus that completes the set. And I would like to mention that during the 100 days also, we were able to arrange or to negotiate for the sending of petroleum engineering instructors from the Philippines, mm-hmm. particularly from Palawan State University and from Batangas State University. For so long, they have been teaching, they have not earned master's degrees, and therefore they have not been made permanent, they have not been promoted. Mm-hmm. Eh, ang gagaling naman nila, but there is no place to go in the country to earn their master's degree. The only way is to go abroad. So we arranged with the University Technology Petronas that these instructors will go there for their master's degrees. They are leaving this month.
Imagine na yan, mga forever, di ba? Lahat ng yan, accomplishment.
Marami pang iba, but yun mm-hmm. yung parang ano, interesting highlights.
Yes. So. Mm-hmm. Napakarami, imagine in sa loob lang ng 100 days. Mm-hmm. Di ba, sir? Mm-hmm. Di ba? Abang natin siguro, next 100 days na naman. Parang
oh,
ganun, no?
Okay. So, oh.
Any final words po, sir? This
well, sa mga tagapakinig, sana eh, supportahan ng ating mga kababayan ang development of science and technology. At hinahangad din namin ang ating kasama iba sa pamahalaan, sa leadership ay mag-full support sa science and technology. Kasi ang pag-asa ng bansa natin na umunlad, malaki ang contribution ng science and technology.
Thank you so much. Maraming salamat po sa inyong oras. Siyempre, for gracing our show. This is our 100th episode. Kayo po nakasama namin.
Maraming salamat po.
Okay. And good luck! More projects pa for your office, from your office. Magkakasama kami
tayo. I wish the best for DOST TV.
Thank you so much! Ayan, mga ka-forever, of course, nakasama natin, walang iba, DOST Secretary Fortunato Dela Peña. Siyempre, maraming salamat for your kind and inspiring words. We are honored at nakasama po namin kayo ngayon at talaga namang nakakataba ng puso ang inyong concern sa mga maliliit na tao at komunidad. With your leadership, the state of science and technology has the promise to go lives and bounce. We wish you all the best at sama-sama pa rin po tayo sa paghatid ng serbisyo sa mga mamamayang Pilipino.
Meet Mark. Mark plans to seek his luck and work abroad. Because of that, he will be needing to get his passport, NBI clearance, NSO, and medical certificate. However, Mark is worried that securing these requirements would be resource and time consuming. Luckily, there is a Tech Friend Center in their barangay. Now, Mark is enjoying the comfort of applying for his NBI clearance, NSO certificate, and passport in the barangay's Tech for Ed Center.
Different people, different places, different stories. Sa loob ng isang daang episode ng DOSTv, marami tayong napulot na karanasan, kasiyahan, at karangalan. Balikan natin ang ilan sa mga ito na handog namin para sa inyo, mga ka-forever.
Mm-hmm. We'll be right back.
Malaki ang papel ng agham at teknolohiya sa buhay ng bawat isa. Sa pamamagitan nito ay napapadali ang mga gawain natin. Naiintindihan natin ang mga pangyayari sa paligid. At sa pamamagitan ng DOST at DOSTv, ang mga serbisyo ng science and technology ay naipahahatid sa mga Pilipino. At sa loob nga po ng 100 araw or episode ng DOSTv, kami po ay lubos na nagpapasalamat sa inyong lahat mga ka-forever dahil simula lang kami ay nagsaging papawid. Ay hindi nyo kami iniwanan, sinamahan nyo kami all throughout our 100th episode at sana po sa mga darating pang pagkakataon, patuloy nyo kaming suportahan sa paghahatid namin sa inyo ng mga serbisyo publiko at sa mga gandang proyekto pa ng DOST. Kami nga ako talaga nagagalak dahil parang ang tagal-tagal na nung samahan namin. Ang DOSTv family ay sobra ang effort, ang pagod para lang maihatid namin sa inyo yung mga magagandang balita, magagandang impormasyon na dapat ninyong malaman at magagamit natin sa ating pang-araw-araw na buhay. And again, maraming salamat po sa bottom po ng aming mga puso. Talagang inihahandog namin sa inyong aming pagtatagumpay at sa mga darating pang pagkakataon ay magkasama-sama pa rin po tayo. And there you have it mga ka-forever. Our 100th episode is over and wish namin na sana samahan niyo pa rin kami sa marami pang episodes. Marami pa kaming handog para sa inyo dahil you'll always have a place in our hearts kasi kayo ang aming mga ka-forever. Kahit anumang mga panahon ang dumating, babalik kami from 11 a.m. to 12 noon Mondays to Fridays. You can visit our webpage at www.dostv.ph and like our YouTube channel or subscribe our YouTube channel www.dostv.ph/YouTube or follow our Twitter and Instagram page dostvph and like our Facebook page facebook.com/dostvph. Kaya naman click na at mag-login para lagi tayong magkasama. Dahil brother lang ang laging nandyan, taga-Romano tag-ulan, hindi nangiiwan kahit sino ka man. Kami ang DOSTv na laging nandyan. May bagyo man, kulog o kidlat, hindi namin kayo iiwan. Dahil laging tandaan, weather is forever.